even when we can't see. We can't see yet, but we believe that he is moving with the love so deep. Hallelujah for the victory. Good things are coming even when we can't see. We can't see yet, but we believe that it's like the brightest sunrise.
Good morning, Northside. Oh, come on, you can do better than that. Good morning, Northside.
Good morning.
All right, everybody happy to be in church this morning. It's good to see you guys. Good to see everybody out in Facebook land. Welcome. Everyone, you want to jump up on your feet? You know how this goes. Melissa's giving me a hard time about this song because this is like old favorite of the church, and the only way that I can hear it in my head right now is hearing Alan Jackson doing Standing on the Promises. So if you guys can kind of sing it along with me, and so I don't laugh when she starts making fun of me, that'd be good. All right, you know this song.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God my Savior. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises I cannot fall, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, and we are standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God.
All right, you may be seated.
Good morning, Northside. It's great to see and have all of you here with us today. Great to have all of you tuning in with us on Facebook Live too as well. We welcome you to our service. I want to just mention a couple of things. Brett Bertram is going to make his way up here in just a minute or two, and he's got an announcement for you. But I want to let you know that we are still taking an offering. We're doing that a little bit differently. If you've brought a check or cash to give on your way out, there's an offering basket that you'll pass by, and you can place it in that. You can also give online too as well, or give through the app. That's the easiest way to do it. So I would encourage you to make that a part of your worship this morning. Brother Brett, I'm going to invite you to come and share. Brett's going to give us an update on our hiring process and where we are at with some things. So, Brett.
Good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing today?
You might have to unmask so they can get the unfiltered Brett. There you go.
All right. So, hiring process. This involved me, Michelle Smith, Mike Spross, Jason Stutzman. We've all been interviewing people, talking to people, doing assessments, all kinds of things throughout the summer. So everybody probably saw the announcement that came out this morning on the app. We're just going through people. We've submitted a couple people to Tim, and we have another interview coming up this week too. So if you have any questions about this, please come to one of the four of us. We're the ones going through everything, bringing people to Tim. So we just wanted you to make sure you knew who
and
to come to.
Brett, maybe we'll have your team stand just in case somebody's not
Mike,
sure who's
Michelle
who.
And Jason
so
stand.
I think the rest of them
Jason's coming
are in there.
In,
there's so. Mike Spross, and there's Jason back there standing.
So any one of the four of us, if you have questions, just come and ask us. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Well, we have someone that's asked to be anointed this morning, and I'm going to ask Antoinette to come forward, and we're going to do it a little bit differently. I'm going to anoint her, and I'm going to ask you to join me just where you're seated, and if you'll just hold a hand out as we pray for her, we're going to lift her up to the Lord. So Antoinette and Victor, if you'll make your way down here, we will anoint you and pray for you. We also want to just celebrate that Jack Littlefield has come home, and you all have been praying for Jack. Yeah, that is a big time praise the Lord. For those of you that don't know or maybe are unaware, Jack had a liver transplant this summer. And so he has been under supervision, just making sure everything is good and holding up well. And he was released on Friday. So we want to continue to pray for Jack and for Kathy and for his family. And so I'll ask you to do that too as we prepare here to anoint Antoinette. Church, if you'll bow your heads with me, if you want to hold out a hand like you're placing a hand on Antoinette in prayer too as well, I encourage you to do that. Jesus, I want to lift up my sister Antoinette to you, and I want to anoint her. I want to pray for a healing touch, Lord, on her body, and Lord, the parts of her body that just aren't feeling well, that maybe aren't working right, we ask for you to help her, to give her strength for each day for the different things and tasks that she does. We're also praying for just a divine touch of healing on her. We thank you so much for her, for watching over her this summer, through being with her through her surgery, and just she is excited, she is on fire, that you love her so much and that you are walking with her through this. And as a church, we lift her up to you. We pray for her. We pray for strength for her and for Victor. And we ask this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Okay. We anoint you too. Okay. We're going to anoint Jen here too. And church, if you'll bow with me and hold out your hand and we'll pray and anoint Jen too as well. Father God, we want to anoint Jen and ask that you would touch her, Lord, wherever it is that she is feeling, wherever it is she's feeling pain, whatever she's dealing with. We're praying for just a divine touch of healing right now for her. And Lord, that you would give her strength and grace for the things that she is doing, and that you would give her strength for being a mother to her kids, teaching. Lord, that you would be with her this week. And we just lift up Jen to you. We pray a special touch on her, and we anoint her in your name. Amen. Amen. Amen, church. Would you stand, church? And we're going to continue worshiping this morning.
All right, how many people remember the Bible verse from last week? Anybody? We're supposed to commit it to memory. Thy word. There we go. I heard a couple of people. All right, well, in interest of getting everybody on the same page, we have a little song to help you remember that. Now, I remember singing this when I was in camp and youth group and stuff. Apparently, that's not universal, so this might be new for some of you. This is Thy Word, and the chorus is the part you're supposed to be memorizing. So, let's.
Speak, freedom reigns.
there is hope in every single word you say. I don't wanna miss one word you speak, 'cause everything you say is life to me. One word you speak, quiet my heart, I'm listening.
Thank you, worship team, Jeff and Melissa. Let's tell them thank you, can we? Well, good morning, Northside. Great to be back with you. We are a church that is on a mission. Our mission is to love Jesus and to love people. Would you say that with me? Love Jesus and love people. Love Jesus and love people. This morning, the message is entitled, we'll see here if it'll advance, must have frozen up here, but the message is called, Are You Listening? Now, please do not look at the person next to you. Don't elbow them, don't nudge them. Don't try to insinuate that this message is for them this morning, because this message is for you. This message is for me. This message is for all of us. Amen. Okay, let's just start right there that we all need to hear this. I want to share a scripture with you, and we'll see if it'll, there we go. If you want to look in your Bible at this scripture, you can too as well. It's in the book of James chapter 1, and it's verse 19. James chapter 1, verse 19 says, My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. Let me allow you to listen to this scripture in a couple different translations. The King James Version says, "Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath." In the Message translation, Eugene Peterson words it this way, "Post this at all the intersections, dear friends. Lead with your ears, follow up with your tongue, and let anger straggle along in the rear." Are you listening? Here's what I would like to have happen when we all leave the service this morning. These are the goals. This is what I'm going to be sharing and talking to you in more detail about. The first thing I want us to understand is that good listening doesn't start with listening. Good listening doesn't start with listening. We're going to unpack that here in just a minute. Here's the second thing that I want you to realize, to take away, to understand. It's to realize that you can share the gospel through listening. You can share the gospel through listening. And then finally, I want you to be equipped with some tools. I want you to have some things at your disposal when you leave here that will help you to listen better. We're going to get pretty practical here towards the end of this. Let me share with you my reason why I am feeling led to share this message with you this morning. This message has been simmering in me for about 5 years. So it's just taken a lot of time. I haven't been listening real well, so that's why it's been there so long. Now, the Christian world that I am a part of, the Nazarene Church, the Church of the Nazarene, and the things that I see happening in this particular world, they concern me. Because I see people not really listening to one another. I see people talking over each other. I see people talking to a person. I see people, you know, shouting and screaming at one another. And I'm talking about within the Nazarene Church, the world that I'm a part of, the world that I know. That's one of the reasons I feel led to talk about this with you and to discuss this as a church. Another reason is because of this pandemic that we're in and the social distancing that we're all practicing, and some of us have been isolated for a long time. Some of you may be here this morning and you haven't been around people for months. Some of you may still be at home and haven't been around people for months. I think that during this time, it's concerning to me, and it seems like we're getting dangerously close to forgetting how to converse one-on-one with somebody, face-to-face with somebody. Instead, we're interacting mostly through screens, and so much is lost when we interact with another person through a screen. And it's really easy to draw up boundaries, to make battle lines, to choose a side, gather your troops, and look at the other side as the enemy. For example, this is again within the Nazarene world that I'm a part of. Just a few weeks ago, I heard two statements that just blew me out of the water. One of them was a Nazarene person saying, All Nazarene pastors should be required to vote for Donald Trump. And if they don't vote for him, we should throw him out of the church. And then on the other side, because this is not a one-sided issue, this is a people issue. But on the other side, somebody was saying, hey, we should find out all the pastors that voted for Donald Trump and we should throw them out of the church. You see, people are drawing up these lines. They're putting their feet in the sand. They're calling people to their side, and they're saying, you're either with me or you're against me, and I'm going to do something about it. And this is crazy talk. We're basically saying, hey, we're going to determine whether or not you're called into ministry, called by God, by how you vote at the polls. That's crazy talk. One of the reasons I feel led to share with you this morning, another reason I was thinking about this, in all the years that I spent in school, I never once had a class that taught me how to be a good listener. It was just expected. Hey, when the teacher talks, you're going to listen. If you don't, you're going to get in trouble. Well, I got in trouble a lot. You know, I also checked with my kids. I asked them, I said, hey, will you ever have a class in school on how to be a good listener? They said, no. I think my son's reply was, you just listen when the teacher talks. Duh. You know, thinking about how we come into this world as people, and thinking about, this goes back to what we talked about last week, there's darkness in every single one of us. Sometimes that darkness manifests itself in selfishness, and that selfishness plays out in our lives by us not listening well. We don't listen well. We come into this world not being great listeners. We come into this world crying, wanting people to serve us, do stuff for us. I've yet to see a baby pop out and say, hey, mom and dad, what can I do to help you? What do you need, mom and dad? I'm here to listen to you. What can I help you with? We don't get training in how to be a good listener. So you know what I was thinking? Why not, as a church, make this something that we talk about? Make this something that I preach about? Make this something that maybe we offer classes on, because we follow the greatest listener in the world, Jesus Christ. How many of you know what I'm talking about? Jesus, he's the one that listened to the poor. Jesus, he's the one that listened to the sick. Jesus, he's the one that listened to the sinners. Jesus, he's the one that listened to the tax collectors. Jesus, he's the one that listened to the Pharisees. Jesus, he's the one that listened to his enemies. Jesus, he's the master listener. How many of you can get excited about that? How many of you have been at a point in your life where you felt like nobody listened to you, nobody understood you, but Jesus did? Who are we following, church? Who are you following? Who are we called to be like, church? Jesus, the master listener. And so why not talk about this? Why not get excited about this? Why not do training in how to be a good listener? Because we're following the greatest listener the world has ever seen. Finally, I believe the spread of the gospel, depends on our ability to listen. So, with these goals, let's go back to these here in just a second. I want to just read this verse to you again before we jump in. James 1:19. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. You know, our mission, loving people, this is something that's going to help us do that better. Learning to listen is going to help us carry out and live out our mission. So let's get into this. Let's talk about this. How about this idea that good listening doesn't start with listening? Anybody puzzled on that? Anybody wondering, what in the world does that mean? Well, if you have your Bibles, I want to invite you to turn with me. I want to just look at a couple verses in Jesus' parable, but turn with me to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8. There's a parable that Jesus tells. I'm not going to read the whole parable, but we're going to talk about a couple points in the parable, and it's the parable of the sower. It's the parable of the farmer who sows his seeds. Now, right off the bat, one of the things we learn about this farmer is that he is extremely generous when it comes to sowing seed, planting seed. By our standards today, every other farmer would hate this farmer. Every other farmer would look at this farmer and be like, man, this guy does not know how to farm. He does not know how to farm, because this farmer is throwing seed everywhere. So he's got a field, he's planting seed in a field, but he's also driving down the toll road with his tractor trying to plant seed. He's going into Walmart with his tractor trying to plant seed. Everywhere he goes, there's seed. And Jesus tells us, hey, want to let you know, I'm the farmer. Before you say, well, that farmer's an idiot, let me just tell you, that farmer's me, Jesus says. And the seed that's being sown, that's the word of God. And then Jesus, as he tells this parable, he describes how people hear the word of God. And he describes four ways. There's some seed that falls on the path that doesn't last very long. There's seed that falls on a rocky path that really can't get any roots. It doesn't last very long. There's seed that falls among weeds and thorns. It gets choked out as it grows, doesn't last very long. And then lastly, in verse 8 of Luke chapter 8, we'll just read this verse here. It says, still other seed fell on good soil. It came up and yielded a crop 100 times more than what was sown. That's a pretty amazing return of interest there. In the kingdom, you know, that return of interest is multiplied. It's not addition, it's multiplication. But each one of these instances, the person hears, the person listens. It says that in the text. Because later, as Jesus is alone with his disciples, and I am so thankful that those disciples said, hey, Jesus, we don't get what you said. Will you explain it to us? Aren't you thankful for those moments in Scripture? Because if we're honest, do we really get what Jesus said sometimes? But they said, Jesus, we don't get it. Can you unpack this parable for us? And Jesus starts explaining the parable to them and how people hear the word and how they respond. And then we get down to verse 15, and Jesus says this. He says, the seed that fell on good soil stands for those with a noble and good heart who hear the word, retain it, and by persevering produce a crop. Now, there's something that we just read there that I always just fly over. I just skip right over it. I don't pay attention to it at all. It's the very first thing that's mentioned before the seed on good soil being described as one who hears the word. It says, those with a noble and good heart. Those with a noble and good heart. In the Bible, the heart is always referred to or related to being this place of choice, this place of decision, this place of intention. Think about that. The person that produces a crop from the word of God that they hear is a person with a noble and a good heart. Well, how would we end up with a noble and good heart? Well, if you're following Jesus, he's given you a heart transplant. He's transforming your heart. He's at work in your heart. And he doesn't just do the transplant and say, hey, I'm done. He continues to work with you all of your life. You know, sometimes when it comes to listening, let's drop the boat anchor here and let's fish here a little bit, can we? Sometimes when we listen to somebody, we're listening to hear what it is that they have to say that we don't agree with, and then we're formulating our response or our reply to them. And we're not really listening and hearing them out. Anybody guilty of that? I could say I've been guilty of that. I think what Jesus is trying to get at here with the person that hears his word and produces a crop or sees multiplication of the word that was sown in their life is the person that has a good heart made good by God, but that's willing to make a choice, make a decision that they're going to hear a person out. Even if it's somebody they don't agree with or somebody that has something to say that they say in the conversation that we don't agree with, we're still going to listen to them. Stephen Covey captures this, I think, in his book, Seven Habits of Highly Effective People. He makes the comment or the quote, most people listen with the intent to reply, not the intent to understand. I really believe that that's what is being said in Luke chapter 8, verse 15, about this good soil. Is the person with this heart that's been made good by God, and it's a person that wants to hear God out with the intent of trying to actually understand. And I believe that that also relates to how we listen to one another. We have to make a choice when we're talking to other people that I want to hear this person out. I want to understand this person. I'm not just listening so I can pull out my notes and my flip chart and show them where they're wrong and why they're wrong. I'm listening to them because I want to understand where they're coming from. And if we push this a little bit further, we could also say that we're going to listen to somebody because they are made in God's image and likeness, just like we are. They are loved by God just as much as we are. Maybe I have some convincing to do there. You know, I think if we were to have a conversation with Jesus in the way that the people in the first century, you know, actually in the flesh. And someday we will when we see him. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You excited about that? I think when we have a conversation with Jesus, we're going to walk away from him feeling like we were really listened to. That we were really understood by him. Because that's how Jesus left most conversations with people. Especially those that had that intent to understand. Now there were some like the Pharisees that they had different motives. They had a different intent when they came to Jesus. They were trying to trick him, trying to capture him. They didn't like him. They didn't want to listen to him. But those that did, Jesus heard them out and he made them feel loved by really listening to them. I believe as a church, we have to get to this point. We have to be able to really listen to somebody in order to understand them. Not just be because we want to reply, because we want to correct something that they've said. And you know, hearing somebody out, letting somebody speak, doesn't mean that you agree with them. Doesn't mean that you have to agree with them. I mean, could you imagine if Jesus were to do some of the things that we Christians do? If Jesus were to do those kind of things to people? I mean, maybe you've gotten into a heated discussion with somebody and you just had enough, so you just zoned out. You pulled out your phone. What if Jesus did that? Do you imagine Jesus doing that with the Pharisees? All right, I'm going to check my Facebook. I'm bored. Or Jesus, he runs into somebody he disagrees with and he just gets up and he walks out. And actually, it would be kind of hilarious because the gospel stories, they would all be the same. It'd be like, Jesus walked into a house, so-and-so spoke up and said something, Jesus walked out of the house. Because think about this. There is something in every single one of us that disagrees with Jesus and that Jesus disagrees with. We're not pure. He's pure. We're not God. He's God. We're not holy. He's holy. Good listening. Here's where it starts. It starts with a choice. It starts with a decision that you make in your heart that you want to listen with the intent to understand, not to reply. And in so doing, I believe we're on the right line to living James 1:19 of being quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to getting angry. Number two here, the goals, what I want you to take away. You can share the gospel through listening. Now, some of you might be thinking, well, that's crazy. You got to speak the gospel. You got to talk about the gospel. And that is true. But before you can do that, as a preacher, before I'm going to preach to you a message, you want me to get alone with God and hear him, don't you? You want me to listen. And in that listening, opportunities are created for us to share the gospel. I remember when I went over to Trina's parents' house, her mom and dad's, with the intent to ask them for her hand in marriage. That was a nerve-wracking day. That was a scary day. I went over there, and the conversations that we had, I was listening intently to every single word that they said. I was listening to specifically how each sentence ended. And I was really hoping there would be a sentence that would end on ring, or wedding, or love, or marriage. Because I had the line ready. Well, speaking of rings, could I ask for your daughter's hand in marriage? Speaking of weddings, I'm glad you brought that up. Could I ask for your daughter's hand in marriage? That never happened. And it was just super awkward. But we got there. We did it. But you know, I was thinking about that. Maybe that's what we need to do when we're conversing with those that don't believe or those that don't have a different opinion than us. Maybe we need to be listening intently to the things that they're saying for those opportunities to come up for us to be able to share the gospel. And sometimes that might actually mean that we're doing more listening than speaking. But my hopes are, as we listen and as people notice our listening, that maybe they would ask us, hey, why do you listen to me? Hey, why do you care so much about what I have to say and what I think? Because then there's an open door to share the gospel. You see, listening creates opportunities to share the gospel. I mean, let's think about Jesus. Let's think about Jesus going to the cross. Jesus went to the cross listening. And I think if we lean into that story close enough, I think we could hear the Father speaking to his beloved Son, saying, "Son, listen to them. They don't understand what they're doing. My Son, listen to them. Their hearts are broken." Can you see this? Can you picture this as Jesus is being flogged, as Jesus is carrying that beam to Golgotha? "My Son, listen to them. They're searching for the truth. My Son, listen to them. Their lives are weighed down by sin. My Son, listen to them. They don't have any hope. My Son, listen to them. They don't know what real love is. My Son, listen to them, because no one else will." Let's just think about how Jesus shared the gospel by being a listener. On his way to the cross, he wasn't giving us a commentary about how things were going. He wasn't complaining about how he was feeling, how the wood hurt his back. He was listening. You can share the gospel through listening. Lastly, here's some tools to help you listen better. Maybe there's one thing that you'll take away, that's fine. Maybe there's many things that you'll take away, that's great too as well, but whatever speaks to you would be great here. One of the tools in my toolbox, one of the habits that I have been working to get myself into that is helping me to become a better listener, is to make the first thing that I hear when I wake up in the morning is God's Word, is the Bible, is Scripture. Allowing God to speak first. Before I'm going to listen to any news, before I'm going to read any news, before I'm going to read anything, I'm going to read the Bible and allow God to speak to me first. And I really believe in practicing this, in doing this, that God is preparing me and teaching me and shaping me to listen to his voice throughout the day and to try and listen to him first. So maybe that's something, maybe some of you already do that. Maybe you get up early and the first thing you do is you read the Bible. Awesome. Keep it up. If you've never done it before, give it a week. Try it. Try making the first thing you hear in the morning God's Word. Another tool for your toolbox, check your attitude. You ever check your attitude? More than likely, your spouse or kids probably checks your attitude more than you. But you know, it's been said that a good listener knows how to listen to themselves. All right, if you're getting ready to go into a meeting and you've just had a fight with your spouse, and you're angry and upset, there's a really good chance that's going to affect the way you go into that meeting and the way you listen and the way you interact with people. So sometimes just knowing what's happened, where you've come from, how you're feeling, is something that can help us to be better listeners. I know it sounds simple, but how often do we carry over problems from one thing to another thing and let them influence the way that we listen? How often do we do that? How often do you do that? Good listeners learn to listen to themselves. See, your attitude, it's going to change 100 times during the day. You may wake up happy, drive to work, now you're mad. Get to work, something great happened, they had donuts, you're happy. You dropped your donut, you're mad. Someone gave you a new donut, you're happy. Your attitude's going to change 100 times during the day. So just being mindful of where you're at when it comes to listening is something that can help us be better listeners. I don't know if he's here or not, but Pete was sharing with me this week that he was on the job and he was working on his blower. And there was a lady that came up to him and was standing there kind of staring at him. And I think she started to say some things to him, maybe tried to help him. And You know how that would be. I mean, a stranger showing up and trying to talk to you, tell you what to do, and then just standing there, you know, for the next 10 minutes as you're working on it. Well, finally, Pete kind of turned things around, and Pete realized in talking to this lady, listening to her, she was homeless, and she didn't have anyone to talk to. And Pete gave her his two ears. He listened to her. He heard her out. He even then tried to take care of the things that she needed. That's being a good listener. That's checking our attitude and really hearing somebody out. Here's another tool for your toolbox. When you're conversing with someone and they say something that you disagree with, pause for a moment and then try and say back to them what they just said to you, but in your own words. Try to repeat back to them what it was that they said in your own words. So somebody comes in fired up, hey, I think this about this and this. We say, okay, so you think this about this and this. But remain calm. Remain calm. That's a key right there. Remain calm. I mean, we could say, are you saying that you believe this about this and this? Okay, that's one way to say it. But if you say it as, are you saying this about this and this? I mean, if you think about it, that's kind of living into Proverbs 15:1. If we do it the right way. Proverbs 15:1 says, a quiet word turns away wrath. Quiets anger. And so think about the way that you might respond. Think about what you might say. And think about your reaction. So, and sometimes when we repeat back what we've heard, there could also be the real possibility that we didn't hear exactly what it was they were trying to tell us. Oh, so you think this, this, and this about this. Is that right? No, that's not what I said at all. Sometimes we may have just completely missed the point. Another thing is just to pay attention to your physical reactions when you're discussing something with someone and there's a disagreement. Pay attention to your physical reactions. I think you know what I mean. If you don't, let me give you a few examples. Somebody says something to you, maybe one of your kids comes up and says just something ridiculous to you that really gets you fired up. Some of you, you have just a blank stare. Which, you know what's great at first, because you're pausing, you're not saying anything, but after about a minute and a half, it gets awkward. It's kind of like, Mom, you, Dad, you going to say anything? Now, some of you do the blank stare with the mouth half open. Some of you, for a little bit more dramatic flair, full mouth open. Some of you are head shakers. Somebody says something that you don't agree with. Some of you are head hangers. That seems like that's more of like a parent to a child. Like, I'm really just... Some of you do the turn away. Not really sure what's going on. Maybe you try to look at, is there something neat happening back there, over there? Some of you are arm crossers. Some of you are deep breathers. Some of you are deep sighers. Some of you have that big, Some of you laugh. Which, that's creepy. If you've ever talked to somebody you disagree with and they laugh, it's like the Joker, man. I just move out of that, get out of there. Some of you, it's like a guy with a golf ball in his mouth. Some of you have that puzzled look. You want me to defuse a bomb? What? Some of you, it's the NBA foul call. Again, all of these things are not things that you're speaking. It's reactions. It's your body language which speaks. It tells, it lets somebody know how good of a listener you're going to be to them. Some of you are like the person that ran into plexiglass. We've got the fidgeter, and they're perfectly still when you're talking to them, but as soon as you say something that upsets them, it's... There's the face wiper, there's the quarter wipe, the half wipe. Watch out for the full wipe. There's touchdown Jesus. Some people, they're not hiding it, man, that they disagree with you and don't want to hear you. And then lastly, you can't forget about orc face. You ever heard of orc face? It's when your bottom teeth are bigger than your top teeth, you know. I'm guilty of this one. You know why I know I'm guilty of this one? That my kids, they know when I'm mad. And I have asked them, how do you know I'm mad about this? And they're like, you got your mean teeth out. Which is super annoying when your kids, you know, pick up on your little habits and call you out on it. But I would just ask you to pay attention to how do you respond when you hear something that you don't agree with. What is your go-to? What do you do? I know all of these so well because I see you guys do it on Sunday mornings when I'm preaching. I'm just kidding. There's a couple of them I haven't seen yet. Here's something else you can do that's a great tool to have in your listening toolbox. Ask questions. Be curious. Jesus practiced this. And there's nothing wrong with asking questions. Hey, tell me why you believe this. Hey, tell me why you're so passionate about this. Why do you feel led to speak up about this? What is it you like about this? Why do you believe what you do? You know, I had a couple instances this summer where I was with family, and it was not just that we were talking about things and we were on different pages. I'm pretty sure that we were talking about things and we were in different books. And I had to really be mindful of, you know, my expression and how I was going to respond to that. But asking questions can help. It can help us maybe to understand where the person's coming from. And then lastly, and this might be the biggest deal yet, is to pray for the person that you're talking to or that's talking to you, that you're listening to. Pray for that person. Pray that God would bless them. If you need a prayer because you're not sure what you could pray in that time, just say, God, I ask that you bless, and fill in the blank with their name. If you don't know their name, give God a description. I'm sure he knows them. Now, the secret is to keep this inside. Don't bring this out and say it when they've said something to you that you don't agree with. God bless you. Because then it goes from being serious to, I think, being sarcastic and not, we're not really wanting to pray for them, but pray for them. I'm going to ask you to push yourself in this. Push yourself in this. This is not easy. When it comes to a Bible verse that's probably the hardest verse to live out, I think it might be James 1:19, being quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to becoming angry. We usually turn that verse on its head, don't we? We're quick to get angry, we're quick to speak, and we're slow to listen. But I believe that our mission is at stake. That if we want to love Jesus and love people better, we've got to become better listeners to one another. You know, I also believe that our relationship with God is at stake here too as well. Because I believe the same measure of listening that we apply to the people around us is the same measure that we use when we're trying to listen to God. I have a hard time believing that, you know, if somebody's just, hey, I don't listen to people that disagree with me. I don't want to listen to people that disagree with me. I won't listen to people that disagree with me. I have a hard time believing someone like that is able to listen to everything that God has to say in here. Because if we're truthful, there's a lot of things in here that are really hard to hear, even as seasoned followers of Jesus. And if we're only willing to listen to people that believe and think and act like we do, there's a really good chance that we're only paying attention and listening to the stuff in here that lines up with where we are at right now. And the other stuff that's maybe a little bit more difficult to hear, we just skip past that. So I believe the measure that we apply to listening to others, including the least of these, is the same measure that we apply to listening to God. I want to be a good listener. I want to be a good listener. Northside, there is a world around us that needs good listeners. Are you willing to take up that mantle? Are you willing to listen? We're going to be back next week, and we're going to be talking about communication. What we say, how we say it. Would you stand with me, church? And would you listen to this blessing from the Lord? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. You're blessed in the name of Jesus. Have a wonderful Sunday afternoon. I did want to let all of you know, Kathy and Orban over here, they are having a delayed 50th anniversary party out in the Connection, and everyone is invited to that. If you don't have a mask, they wanted me to let you know they do have masks at the door if you need one. So congratulations, guys, on the marriage, the anniversary. That's exciting. So God bless, Northside. Have a great day.